click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, welcome back to the subject of Machine Design 1. In the last lecture, which was a very small lecture, we have gone through the various parameters, various dimensions which are associated with screw jack. Now let me tell you that screw jack is an application of power screw, because there we use power screw, of course, a screw, a kind of screw, right? But screw jack is a particular application where we use it for, you know, lifting objects with minimal efforts. So in the last lecture, we have just gone through the cross section, the figure, the dimensions, what are the different sections called. We are going to quickly revise them, of course, not in terms of dimension, but in terms of the parts. And in today's section, we are going to look at the functioning, working of that particular part. Like I keep on saying this, when we need to design something, we need to know how it is going to fail. And if we need to know how it is going to fail, we need to know how its functioning is, right? So that's why we are going to look at the functioning in the beginning. Then we'll go through the detailed design, not in detailed design, but the brief of the formulae that we are going to use for this particular design. And in the next lecture, we'll be starting with the numerical, which is based on the screw jack design. So it's the design of screw jack, design aspects and formulae, basically formulae we are going to look at. Let's quickly revise. This is how the diagram was. So this is the cross section of the screw jack, where this is the main body, right? So they call it frame. Then this is the main hero of our design, that is screw. Of course, it comes with the threads, external threads. Then this is the nut through which the screw actually passes. Of course, we have to hatch it. And there comes the cup, which is an integrated part, which actually, supports the load, which is acting on that particular screw jack. And this is the last thing, which is handle. Now, guys, you need to understand this functioning properly, that when the load is kept on this particular cup, it is associated through this channel with the screw, of course, which is passing through the nut and which is supported by the frame. So that is how the assembly is. So main component is frame, which is going to be at the basement, on which the nut is mounted or fixed, you can say, by some means, some fastener, through which a screw is passed and which is free to rotate, of course. And the top, the cup is mounted, which is going to sustain the load. Now, how the functioning is? It's very simple. This provided a handle. Now, this handle has a capacity to rotate in the vertical plane. So, after rotation, this particular thing will enable this screw to move upward or downward. So, basically, the rotational motion of the handle is converted into the translational motion or the rectilinear motion of this particular screw. So that is how the main aspect is. We have to design this screw such that it will sustain not only the axial load, but also the rotational load. A rotational load generally brings in the shear stress into picture. Accordingly, we have to design this nut. Accordingly, we have to design this frame. We have to design the cup. And very important, we have to design the handle, which will be able to sustain not only this axial loading, but also the rotational loading. So basically, there are only two problems or two functioning aspects that we need to consider, which are the axial loading, due to which either compression will be in picture, either tension will be in picture, the crushing will be in picture, and next is rotation, through which the shear will be in picture. And of course, as we know, that principal stress is the basic parameter that we consider for the design of screw, which will come into picture. So that is how the functioning of screw jack is related with the problem statement or the problem that we can occur. So this is what the basics of this particular thing. Let us move ahead and look at the design aspect, the actual design aspect. Like I said, there are 4 to 5 different important parts. The very first part is the screw. Of course, we know that we consider principal stresses theories for this particular failure, and hence we have to find out the principal stress. But principal stress in this particular application, which is basically for the crushing load or the compressive load, we have to find out the compressive stress. Formula is very simple. The load P, you can use the letter W also for the axial load. And this is the area of cross section of the core diameter of the screw, of course. Based on which we have to refer to the table, as we did in the last lecture, we have to refer to the table from PSG, and we have to find out the standard values of outer diameter, the pitch dimension, the mean diameter for this particular screw. So this is basically the selection of the standard available part of this screw. Now once it is selected, we have to see whether it is safe or not. Apart from this dimension, other dimensions also we can go for, like the diameter inner. And all. Based on that, we are going to calculate the torque which is required. The torque which is going to act on this particular body, not required, sorry. Torque which is going to act on the body. The formula is very straightforward and simple. Again, we have used this formula before. It's the load into this particular application or the formula where your alpha and phi are the helix angle, and your phi is your angle of friction. Second thing is, there is a replacement for this particular formula. Sometimes the data provided or the data available can vary, and that's why these two empirical formulae you'll find again in the section of screw jack from PhD data book. You just have to refer to the index. Right now I don't have the index with me, but next time I'll try to bring the index so that there will be a better reference for us. So in the PhD, in the section of screw jack, you can find out all these empirical relations. Now this is a quite complex relation, but it's very simple. The length, the L factor is nothing but the lead. Now lead is something, in simple language also, lead is something that we take apart. The lead here, which is related with the screw, is nothing but the advancement of the screw in one revolution. So basically, now again, we know this from computer and machine drawing that for various screws, there's an important factor that is called number of starts, right? If the number of start is one, which is in general case, it's very easy to define the lead in terms of pitch. So in a case when the number of start for the screw is one, the lead is nothing but equal to the pitch of that. So that is nothing but the advancement in terms of length of the screw when it completes one revolution. So for first start or one start, we have lead is equal to the pitch. Then mu is something that is called coefficient of friction that we all know. Like I said, alpha and phi are the helix angles and angle of friction. So if, once we know these parameters, we can substitute them here back in this equation and we'll find out the torque. Unlike in the previous example, we had found out two different torques and then we had gone for the combined torque. In this case, we already know that relation and we can find out the torque. Now this is the torque which is going to act on the given example, the example that will be given, of course. Once the parameters are found, see, design is very simple. You have to find out a couple of parameters and then you have to go for the standard selection from the PhD data book. Then you have to see whether that particular selection is safe or not, and that is what we are going to do. So we are going to check for the failure based on principal stresses first. For that, we will be finding out the compressive stress, as it is, it's very simple. Compressive stress will be the force divided by area of cross section. Need not write the equation. Shear stress will be based on again the rotation or the torque. The torque we already have found out, and that will give me the values which will be induced in the given parameters or in the given problem based on the given loadings. We know that sigma max, or in other way we'll say sigma 1 comma 2, these are the principal stresses. Formula again remains the same. We'll find out the principal stresses. Also we'll find out the maximum shear stress that is possible in this particular stress. Now why we are doing this, guys? You need to understand these two steps are important, just because it is going to undergo the combined stress of crushing and, or say, compressive and say shear, and that's why we are going to consider these factors. We are finding on the basis of the maximum stress, this is principal, and the shear stress. Once these values are found out, we are going to cross check them with the allowable values. So there comes something that's called material selection. You can do that particular thing before this step, or you can do it after this step. So we'll do this for the allowable values. So once, or for this you can use this particular nomenclature or notation, sigma c allowable and tau allowable. So we are going to compare those values with this. Else, if they are not safe, we are going back and we are going to change d mean, which is the mean of outer and inner. So in case, or in short, we are going to change the replacement itself, or the we are going to make the replacement for the standard selection. So once that standard selection, will go for the next value, and then we'll verify this. So it's a trial and error method, but in most of the cases we'll get the safe value for this. So that is was the comparison. Second thing comes is the design of the nut. We have done the design of the screw, which was zero. Now there comes the design of nut. Now design of nut actually goes for the pressure. It bears the pressure because it is in between the frame, and then the screw actually goes through it, and hence it has to undergo the bearing pressure. The formula is very simple. It's the applied force divided by area of cross section, which is undergoing this. So this is the outer diameter minus the core diameter, because that is the only part which is going to sustain this kind of pressure into number of threads. Of course, the more number of threads are going to add, so that is how the area is going to be considered. So this will give me number of threads in my case, right? Because I already have these values with me. So this is how the number of threads will be obtained. Now again, there is a standard relation that we know. The height of nut is basically is equal to number of threads into the pitch, and that is how I'll get the height also. Now these are the only two parameters which are associated with a nut, and hence we have to check it for the crushing. The crushing happens about it. So sigma crushing again will be given by the load, the axial load, divided by area of cross section, where the outer diameter and core diameter comes into picture, and the number of threads. So this will give me the crushing stress that is induced, and I have to compare it with the stress, allowable stress of course. Now there comes the shear factor. Like I said, the shear factor also comes into picture in case of nut, and hence I have to check whether the shear is going to be safe or not, where the load is very simple, axial load divided by the projected area which is undergoing the shear. So it is basically the circumference into number of threads. So one circumference into number of threads, that's the total area, into there is a factor T, which is basically equal to pitch divided by 2. So this will give me the shear value which is induced in this. I have to compare it shear value allowable. If it is fail, I'll go back, I'll change this dimension, and then I'll verify the this particular safety again. Let's move ahead. There are certain important dimensions apart from the nut and the screw which are associated with them. So these dimensions, of course, we have already seen in the last lecture, where we have seen these different dimensions and their significances. I'm not going to repeat them, but these are the standard formulae which are associated for the outer diameter, then the larger diameter, the thickness of a nut collar. The nut has the collar section given for its sitting arrangement on the frame. So that collar thickness is T, and it is basically given by this particular formula where we have all these values except T. So you can find it out. There comes the D3 diameter dimension, again mentioned in the description in first video. And there comes the fourth diameter, D4, which is the pin diameter. Now, pin is something that is used to attach the nut with the main body, main frame, right? So it is assumed that the D4 dimension is 1/4 as that of the D3 dimension. So it's again an empirical relation you can find out. And thereafter, there are two more parameters which we need to design. One of them is handle, and there comes the body, which is the frame. Now, the procedure for them is again lengthy, and we can't cover it in one lecture. So, we are going to illustrate this particular aspects directly in the problem itself. And of course, there will elaborate and explain you how these factors are coming into picture, the design factors. So, this was from my side as far as this design and formula are concerned. In the next lecture, we'll be starting with the numerical based on design of screwjack. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to Ekeeda. Thank you.